In this beautiful book, Handbook of the Radio Technology of, say, the 1950s, receivers and amplifiers, in the Netherlands and Indonesia anyway. A very good and interesting book, and all the people that tributed to this book, made by Rens and Rens, that was also a very famous education company. Anyway, here it is all about the low frequency part of a radio receiver. And that's all, say, very common, say, the audio amplifier here, kind of a filter, and here the loudspeaker. There are very interesting, say, calculations about the power that such a radio, say, a common radio for every purpose, all-purpose radio, but it needs, of course, a certain amount of energy sent to the loudspeaker. And there is here a very interesting calculation, and I cannot show all the exact properties because I want to focus on other things. Here about the sensitivity of the radio. Here, say, the common way to make a low frequency amplifier for a radio application, of course with tubes, doesn't matter much. Here we have the diode that detects the AM radio signal. Here it's amplified by a pentode, and here the end amplifier. Common. And of course, nowadays, even in 2020, you can make such a circuit. No problem, even with tubes. This is perhaps interesting. Volume control where no current flows through the potentiometer. And you can also use this, apply this in a transistor circuit. Decouple here the DC and then send it also via a coupling capacitor to the transistor. Here it's a pentode, but anyway, the whole issue is that no current flows here through the volume control. That gives all kinds of strange creaking sounds, etc. By the way, this is the most important thing and everything that I wanted to tell. Here we have the so-called physiological volume control for the low frequencies. When you want to play music on a very low audio level, you will see, without this kind of control, that the low frequencies are not amplified so much. So the music gets a kind of, say, bleak sound. It's not warm, the sound is not warm, the sound is not natural. And this is one of the ways to correct that. The physiological volume control. And you see here, say a resistor, but you can use it as a potentiometer. And on the tap, here on that tap, on the very low tap of that potentiometer, there is a capacitor. and perhaps even a resistor. I don't know that exactly, but anyway, the capacitor is the most important electronic component. When you say switch the audio level down, on a certain moment you will hear switch in a capacitor. That capacitor is for say transistor circuits approximately 1 microfarad or so, or for 117 microfarad. You can use this circuit for that experiment. This is my earlier video, and this was that schematic that I showed in that earlier video, but you can also use this circuit for, say, a physiological sound control. When you use, for instance, here at first a coupling capacitor, and here an out coupling capacitor, and here in between that resistor with a switch, or you can use a potentiometer, and on the wiper connect that say 1 microfarad capacitor, and when you move the wiper of that potentiometer down on a certain moment, the physiological volume control will kick in. I didn't test it, but it's a very, very good idea to use it. And here are, in this article of the book, also many, say, frequency characteristics that this circuit gives. There are four, here they tell, there are four, say, settings of the potentiometer. Anyway, a very good idea to do an experiment, and you can use this circuit for such an experiment. This amplifies maximum 300 times, and also this, so there will absolutely be no loss of amplification. And so you can use here, try to use here, that physiological sound control. It was used especially in the 1960s and in the 1970s. Of course, there are hi-fi purists that don't believe in this, say, loudness control. They tell, for instance, that the sound is colored in that way. But when you want to play music on a very, very low level in your room, in your living room, you need a kind of loudness control to make the, say, music sound a little bit natural. Here are the frequency characteristics with the physiological sound control. You can see that the on, say, 70 up to 200 hertz band, the control has the effect that the frequencies are lifted up. This is, of course, another part of the frequency band going to, say, 10,000 hertz, but that's not very important in this case. It's all about lifting up, giving the low frequencies on a low audio level, say, a good volume. That is everything, of course, to do with the loudspeaker boxes. They must be able to amplify, or not amplify, but reproduce the frequencies in this low frequency band. But anyway, I hope it was a little bit clear. for test purposes, you can use this, but also you can use a one transistor stage and then say attribute this part of the circuit to the first transistor stage, and then of course use a coupling capacitor, because otherwise with such a volume control or potentiometer, when you say solder it directly to the base, the circuit will surely not work. So here you can use such a filter, and also here with coupling capacitors in and out, etc., and also here an output coupling capacitor. Here much more about linear distortion. Anyway, that's a kind of other issue. Linear distortion means that not all the frequencies, say frequencies with different frequencies, waves with different frequencies, are not all amplified in the same way. Can be caused by the loudspeaker transformer. That's not actual now. In 2020 we have, of course, say transistor amplifiers, capacitors can cause that, etc. Some ideas about tone control. This is very, very old school. The tone control is, say, adding capacitance or lowering capacitance to the primary of the end transformer, the audio transformer. And here we have a tone control in between two stages. Here tube stages, but here we have transistor stages. They do in fact the same, though the impedance, output and input impedance, is very low. And here the output and input impedance is very high. Anyway, type of controlling the sound characteristic with a resistor here and a capacitor. That capacitor of course gets much more effect when the wiper is moved here to this position, and of course this also plays a part in the way that that it is filtered, etc. Of course the input and output impedance plays a part anyway. Tone control at the input of an amplifier, you can use that, this, copy this to a transistor circuit like here. Here it's the tone control is in the back coupling, and that means that from the output you send in the complete audio signal to the input, but it's filtered in between, and that's very, in a kind of way, a problem, because the circuit can start to oscillate. I only have a few seconds to explain that better. Anyway, backcoupling here again, and here we have the so-called Nyquist diagram, and that tells us when the audio amplifier, for instance this one, could also be this one with tubes, starts to oscillate. That's a problem. Here are, in a kind of way, the safe ways that have everything to do with the phase shift. Anyway, there are much videos on my YouTube channel where I have told more about it. Not with this Nyquist diagram, but in a simpler, easier way.